diagnostic possibility, but because of the treatment gambles. So overzealous treatment of DKA can lead you to hypoglycemia as a complication. Please forget about the HHS in this patient. Small hypoglycemic state occurs in older persons in the context of poor feeding and hyposmolarity and all that. So that one is out. We are going to look at very quickly at management of DKA in hospital settings in Uganda, and that's just an emphasis. But suffice it to mention that this patient did not have type 1 diabetes. There's what we call DKA prone type 2 diabetes. That's what her diagnosis is. The old textbooks will link DKA with type 1 diabetes, but now we know that DKA occurs in type 2 diabetes more often than we think. The phenotype of this patient, despite the age of 20-something, is definitely a phenotype for type 2 diabetes. So even though we haven't done the antibodies, there's all reason to believe that this is not type 1. One of the things we also read behind, for those of you who saw the doses, you cannot manage type 1 diabetes with 10 units of mixed herb and then 5, the kind of insulin doses that this patient was controlled on. That can't happen in type 1 diabetes. We're going to talk very briefly since we have very little time. Some of the common presentations we have in our settings, and in Oxford textbook of medicine, they'll tell you that no death occurs in the civilized world for DKA. I hope that's the same for Chigudu Hospital. Commonly we see it presenting in type 1 diabetes, but as I mentioned, it also occurs in type 2. In our setting here, infection is the commonest trigger, but elsewhere myocardial infarction, post-surgical states are common triggers. Next slide. We are here just to talk about early and prompt recognition, because it is deadly, and then talk about the appropriate management and then prevention of the ketoacidosis. I'm happy with this patient that the ketoacidosis did not rebound while still in Chirubi. It happens all over again that after 2 days of non-insulinization, they revert back to ketoacidosis. But cheers to the team, this patient didn't do that. It's an acute metabolic disorder, usually when the glucose is above 350, accompanied by ketonemia. So without ketonemia and ketonuria, you just have hyperglycemia alone. Our particular patient had definitely ketonuria, and these patients have existing symptoms, and then what we call air hunger or post-mal breathing. Now the air hunger will confuse many people. You heard the presenter saying there was dyspnea. That wasn't dyspnea, it was just air hunger. You heard the presenter giving oxygen to this patient. We don't give them oxygen. You heard the presenter worried about the SpO2 of 87. Don't be worried about that. Just a mark of peripheral vasoconstriction. So we don't usually have any serious issues. Oxygen to these people, please. And interpret the SpO2 in that context. They have virtually little blood in the nail bed for you to get a proper SpO2. The severe dehydration with osmotic diuresis, anaerobic metabolic acidosis, ketonuria, hyperkalemia, but with a low total body potassium, and uncertain breath. Let me also mention this here that this particular patient began with a very low potassium, which is a very serious issue. Before you give this patient the first dose of insulin, you should have given a dose of potassium. I don't know at what point you gave your potassium. Concurrently, at the very beginning. Okay, so that was right. If you give this patient potassium like 3 doses later, after 3 doses of insulin, you could kill her with that potassium of 3.3. That was very low. Because even with the hyperkalemia, you already have a low total body potassium. But if you begin with the hypokalemia at the beginning, like this patient, your potassium issues are more problematic than your glucose issues. And again, many times we don't have potassium, so we end up losing these patients. Next slide. It's just about the pathogenesis, why the ketones come in. We shouldn't dwell much on it. Next slide. And these are the investigations that should be done in the usual setting. The X-ray.
For purposes of the students, adaptive students, I think it's important for you to point out why they have hypokalemia.
Why they have hypokalemia? Okay, let's go back to the previous slide. Basically, the main issue is the acidosis. In DKA, we have severe acidosis. Although our patient didn't have severe acidosis, there was a mild decrease in the bicarbonate. Now, when we have acidosis, we have a shift of potassium from the intracellular space to the extracellular. Normally, potassium is an intracellular cation. And when the context of acidosis, we have it moving from inside the cell to the exterior. So that explains why there is a hyperkalemia. But because of excessive diuresis, urinary water losses, most of this potassium which has come in the extracellular fluid is lost into the urine. That's why even though you find a hyperkalemia, your patient has lost most of the potassium because there's nothing in the cell. And as you give the insulin and the glucose begins to normalize, there's a shift of the potassium from the extracellular back into the intracellular. And that's why if the potassium was 3.3 at the beginning and you give insulin without giving potassium, you're going to kill that person. Because the potassium is going to shift from extracellular where it is 3.3 back into the cells. And I don't know whether your reader will be able to read whether there's any potassium in that person. Of course, there's no autopsy finding for hypokalemia. Next slide. So basically the investigations are done, but of course we don't generalize. Sometimes you may do different investigations given the context of your patient. Sometimes we have DKA in labor, DKA in early pregnancy, DKA after septic abortion. So the investigations will differ, but these are some of the common investigations that you must do, but please, you must always demonstrate the ketones. It's very easy to have hyperglycemia without ketonemia. And in that case, not ketoacidosis. In this case, we can't do the blood gases, but where you can do them, you should be able to do them. The issues of the heart are very important. Blood culture, you heard somebody talking about the blood cultures, the urine cultures. Now, one important reason for the chest X-ray, the presenter said it was because of dyspnea. No, again. We are trying to look for chest infections. It's the most important reason. In our setting here, tuberculosis is common, but pneumonia is even commoner than tuberculosis. Next slide. I think most of these were done for a patient. Next slide. These are typical laboratory findings that you are going to have. What we didn't talk about here was the anion gap, which we're not able to measure in this patient. And then the blood gases, which were not done. The bicarb in our patient was 19. I don't know why it was that high, but usually it's much lower than that. Next. Now, in the usual setting, this slide shows what is done elsewhere, where the facilities are quite good. Of course, you have to correct the hypovolemic shock with saline, and that's normal saline. Whereas we talk about fast rehydration, again, we have issues of individualization. There are some patients who have chronic kidney disease, then renal failure, and you have to not give them the rapid fluids. But in our setting here, we normally give the liter per hour. And usually it's good to work towards a goal. Usually we say about 6 liters deficit that should be collected in the first 6 hours. And of course, potassium. Now, in our context here, we're not able to do potassium levels that quickly. I'm a bit suspicious how these people got this potassium. So quickly, but I'm happy. I hope it wasn't a retrospective reason. But usually we don't have potassium right at the very beginning. And if you don't have a potassium at the very beginning, first look at the urine bag. If the urine bag is empty, be careful about giving potassium. Or give it under an ECG monitor. Next slide. I hope you know that lethal injection by the courts of law is done by potassium chloride. So we don't want to replicate that here. We normally give insulin at 0.1 units per kg per hour by infusion. And again, in our chirurgical settings, we don't have insulin pumps. We don't have, infusion pumps. But sometimes, that is the general guidance we give, 0.1 units per kg per hour. But if it doesn't, then we go up by a ratio of 10-20% if it is not falling quickly, and then do the other monitorings. So this is what you've done. You do the ideal situations. Next slide. But sometimes we're not able to do all that. The commonest problems or killers are hypoglycemia and hypokalemia. And then acidosis, which is not improving. Especially pneumonia is common. And then there is the issue of the disequilibrium syndrome, where we get cerebral edema. And again, this is a treatment complication where if you have overzealous reduction in the random in the blood sugar, you end up with disequilibrium, whereby there's an osmotic shift of fluid from the peripheral to the intracranial space. Normally, we recommend that you should not reduce by more than 50 millimoles per hour. If your sugar is like 400, don't want to get to 250 in 1 hour. You're going to precipitate this disequilibrium syndrome. And how you notice this, but of course it's common in children, is the patient initially recovers from the ketoacidotic coma and then suddenly goes back into coma. So two reasons why they go back into coma, or three. One, rebound DKA. Two, hypoglycemia. Three, disequilibrium syndrome. Next slide. Now in Uganda, back to reality. We have limited diagnostics, we have limited training and awareness, and that limited is going to go away this afternoon. We have limited structural designs for DM care, limited treatment options, limited follow-up care plans, limited food availability and attitude. That's Uganda. Next slide. Our common triggers are infections, UTI, pneumonia, malaria, septic, diabetic feet and the like. But the third bullet, withdrawal of insulin therapy is very common in our setting because of, for two reasons. One is unavailability, two is the patient factor. Many of our patients, even when they have drugs, they feel like not having them and say, let me rest a bit. Surgery, pregnancy, myocardial infarction, tuberculosis, viral infections, skin and soft tissue infections, meningitis, all these are common triggers. And that's why the patient needs an extensive workup in the history, examination, and investigations. There will be something lacking. And interestingly, in my practice, most of the patients I've had with miliary TB and DKA have passed away. Next time I'll hand them over to Dr. May. Next slide. Because it is difficult to control miliary TB fast enough to control DKA. So you can train me next how to best it, but they have all passed away. So quick history, look at the symptoms, look at the signs that we've done. Next slide. Remember that epigastric pain is a common finding, and some patients have ended up on the surgeon's table for open and see. Only to find they have DKA. Pericapsular inflammation of the liver capsule, but the actual mechanism is not known. Physical exam again should look at really extensively. I can't go through all this, but I just want to make the fact that in the last slide that it is a case by case basis. We don't make everything for everybody the same way, case by case. One of the most intriguing cases I've seen and managed, and again that have baffled me, is following septic abortions. And again, I've seen most of these young ladies pass away. because post-abortal sepsis is so widespread, it's so difficult, and the infective load is so high. Some of them have had this, they have been poked by bicycles, pokes, and what? They have tetanus and everything. They're quite difficult. So it is key for you to individualize each patient and approach appropriately. Next slide. The lab tests, we have already passed through some of these, but remember to do the ketones and for confirmation of your diagnosis, and then the electrolytes, particularly the potassium that is a guide in our treatment. Next slide. The done labs are those that are done on a case-by-case basis of research, including cardiac enzymes, relevant radiographic scans, x-rays, CT scans for diagnostic purposes, blood cultures, LPs. In our setting here, tuberculosis is quite important, an abdomen exam. So you individualize, as I say. Next slide. Now, initial intervention, of course, intravenous access should be established with a tubal cannula, and rapidly infuse these patients, again with individualization, 1 liter per hour, but you diminish it in those with poor renal function or heart failure, pulmonary edema. I've come across some people who cram these things, 1 liter per hour. Somebody walks in, he has pulmonary edema, they give 1 liter per hour. Then next is the nurse brings the death certificate book. So always listen to the lung pressures of your patient. Sometimes the breathing that you are calling cosmol breathing is actually pulmonary edema. So be careful. Now, we don't have the rapid acting insulin. I don't know, Dr. Pereira, whether you have them on your side, but the most rapid acting insulin we have in children is still soluble insulin, but the pediatrician will tell us what they have their side. We give 10 units per hour, and we lower glucose at 15 milligrams per deciliter per hour, not more than that, to avoid the dyscobrium syndrome. And when sometimes the blood glucose level refuses to go down, we increase to 20 units, but again with the more serious monitoring. We normally say the intern should not go back to his or her room until the DKA is cleared. If you are an intern and the DKA is still on, you remain on site. Next slide. Now, at that magic level, in our case, they did it at 14 millimoles. We switched to less acting insulins or the sliding scale. I must mention that the beta world has stopped sliding. It is only in Uganda where we are still doing sliding scale. Next slide. And this is the guide that we use as to... This is a chart that you should have in your head so that it can guide you which fluids to give, at which glucose levels. These are just general guides again. And these are the charts that we use in our current basis in our hospitals. Next slide. Then afterwards, remember that if you relax, the patient will go back in ketoacidosis. And hypoinsulinization or non-insulinization is a common factor for that. What normally happens is that most of our nurses are used to giving 6-hour treatments, but a gap of 6 hours is too long for a patient recovering from ketoacidosis. So if you leave the patient at 6 p.m., as most interns do, having recovered well from ketoacidosis, believe me, in the morning, you'll find them in ketoacidosis again. So it should really be continuous care, continuous insulinization, and then the fixing, like it was done in our patient, also happened. But remember that for type 2 diabetes, we use lower doses, like for type 1 diabetes. I think normally the pediatricians are going up to 16 units per day. Our patients did well with 15 units, and that's why I'm comfortable that it's a type of diabetes. Next slide. Potassium, again, we have the injectable form, which should be part of the emergency trolley in every reasonable hospital. You should have IV potassium with you. If the patient begins with a low potassium, give potassium before the first shot of insulin. If you don't have the potassium level done, at least by the third dose, you should have given the first dose of potassium. If you don't have any potassium, you give 600 milligram tablets or juices like passion juices. Now this is going very bush-like. If you have nothing to do, give concentrated passion fruit juice. I mean, what do? You don't have the stuff. You can't pretend that there's potassium always. Next slide. But please, don't just give potassium anyhow. If you've just taken your two bottles of beer, refer the next in time. Leave these things to others. Eh? You need to look at your particular patient before you kill them. You can easily kill a person with DKA. Good enough, some of these things are becoming commoner, the handheld ECG monitors and the like. But where you have them, you can also look for ECG signs of potassium over-administration, like PR prolongation, tethering of T-waves, widening of choice complexes, VTAC, VFib. Don't wait for all that nonsense. But if you have a monitor, these are the things to look for. Next slide. About the Skrubrium syndrome, of course you have to prevent it. And the Skrubrium syndrome has a very high mortality, so you don't want to go there. And you can give some money to if your patient has entered into it. Please remember to manage the trigger at the same time as you're managing the DKA. Like I've mentioned, there are two triggers that disturb me. One is the mere TB, the other one is septic abortion. You can advise me, take me back to school and teach me how to manage those two triggers. They are very problematic. If you don't attend to the trigger, you may lead to failure or recovery from the DKA. Or the glucoses go down, then they come up again. I remember one patient whom we didn't know, but the underlying trigger in this case was use of dexamethasone. So the patient had Dexa, she was always taking it, we didn't pick it in the history, we lowered the sugar. When she woke up, she took her other dose. Again, we struggled, she went into coma, she came back. When she woke up, took another dose. But we didn't know what was happening until we saw the Dexa by the bedside of the patient. And that's when we were able to get it sorted. Sadly so, in our setting here, the biggest killer of DKA is not hyperglycemia, but hypoglycemia. Next slide, we should be ending. Prevention, apart from being better than chewa, is very important. And in our setting here, the issue of this continuation of insulin therapy should be looked into. And then infections, infestations, trauma, surgery, myocardial infarction. Remember that many of you will be called by the surgeons to help them in the preparation of a patient before surgery, before major surgery. So this is what you should look into. Don't send the patient on the table with a hyperglycemia. You tip them over into a DKA. Definitely nobody wants a DKA on the table. It can occur. Don't ask me which textbook read about its management, but it can occur. That should be the last. Anything beyond that? Thank you very much.